Hello, and welcome to HRG's monthly webinar. A recording of this webinar and slides will be available shortly at hrgpros.com/webinars after the presentation. You will also get an email with that link as well. Time permitting, there will be a Q&A session at the end of the webinar. If we run out of time, we will make the answers to the additional questions available to you all. If you would like one external CAU for attending this webinar, please email YourPartner@hrgpros.com, the end of the presentation. We also have a slide with that email address on it, and we'll get multiple emails, so no worries, we'll make it available to you. Please note it can take up to 7 days for the email delivery of the CEU, but we'll definitely get them to you all. I am delighted to hand this over to Laura Legg, 30-year HRIM veteran and HRG's Executive Director of Revenue Integrity and Compliance. Great wealth of knowledge. So Laura, let you take it away.
Well, thank you, Krista, and hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, The Sepsis Code. I'm very happy to be with you today and hoping to shed some light on this complicated diagnosis of sepsis, the documentation, and the coding of that condition as well. Coders have struggled for decades with the coding of sepsis, and today we're going to discuss some of the reasons why, and facilities are now struggling with retaining the revenue from the sepsis DRG. So today, we're just going to have a really practical discussion about those issues, and we're going to talk about how does a coder stay in compliance with the official coding guidelines, follow the advice of the American Hospital Association Coding Clinic and the cooperating parties, and still help their facility retain that much-needed revenue that we get from our sepsis DRGs. For many hospitals, volume-wise, sepsis is their number one DRG. So it's very significant that we have this discussion today. This slide is just a disclaimer to let you know that, Laura, I am not a legal expert. The first authority for coding is always the official coding guidelines and the American Hospital Association Coding Clinic. What I'm sharing with you today is taken from those guidelines and from my own personal experience. I also want to make it clear that I'm not a clinician. It is the physician's clinical judgment that's required to make any diagnosis, including a diagnosis of sepsis. So although we will discuss some of the clinical indicators for sepsis, remember that clinical validation is not a coding issue, it's a clinical issue. How did I become interested in the coding of sepsis? In 2009, I was working for a major health system in the Pacific Northwest. And they, when the RAC started up, the recovery auditors for Medicare, they changed my job over and I was their RAC coding consultant. So I traveled to 5 different hospitals responding to RAC denials, and many of those denials were for records that had been coded with the principal diagnosis of sepsis. So I continued that interest throughout the years, and I'm here to share some of what I learned with you today. The objectives of our webinar today are really to answer some questions about why sepsis is so challenging and examine those coding challenges. We're going to look at some of the areas where clinical documentation opportunities can really make a huge difference. And we're going to talk about a multidisciplinary approach to protecting revenue for DRGs 870 through 872. And at the last, we're going to talk about taking advantage of the process of pre-bill audit. And note that next month our entire webinar will be a full webinar about the power of pre-bill audits, and we're going to actually examine a workflow that you could use to do that. So that would benefit not only sepsis, but all diagnoses in the inpatient world. So let's go ahead and get started. One of the first things I want to point out to you is that the financial high-dollar diagnoses that we have in the inpatient world, and you can see that the highest dollar is sepsis. This number of $20.3 billion is a little bit outdated because it now is about $24 billion that we have in aggregate cost every year for the diagnosis of sepsis. And you can see we have 4 more high-dollar diagnoses, but none of them really come close to the cost of sepsis. Most people, more people, I should say, die from sepsis than from prostate cancer, breast cancer, and AIDS combined. It's also the number one financial burden for hospitals with nearly, like I said, $24 billion in costs every year. On this slide, I'm sharing with you some of the financial facts regarding the cost of sepsis. And you can see that it is the most expensive reason for hospitalization. It kind of blows my mind to think that $55 million is spent on sepsis care per day in U.S. hospitals, but the average length of stay, of course, is almost double a stay for other diagnoses. And the rate of this is growing. And the other thing that uses a lot of resource utilization is that survivors of sepsis are likely to be discharged to follow-up care, which can cost up to $2 billion per year. So you can see that this is indeed an expensive diagnosis, but really there's an even greater cost to the patients and families who unfortunately face this life-threatening illness. Here is a video done by the Sepsis Alliance that I would recommend you watch. I would have loved to have shown it during our webinar today, but there just wasn't time. The Faces of Sepsis is an excellent video which really can help you understand what the real cost of sepsis is. Sepsis is serious business, and the sooner we can find better ways to deal with sepsis, not only from a clinical standpoint, but also from a financial standpoint for hospitals, all the better off we'll be. So I promised to talk about some of the challenges around sepsis, and so I'm going to start with this list. And I think one of the most challenging is the unclear definitions around the diagnosis of sepsis. And there are many. The very first person to discover that an infection could spread to the bloodstream was Hippocrates in 500 BC. And so much more recent for us was in 1991 when the American College of Chest Physicians agreed upon definitions for SARS, sepsis, severe sepsis and septic shock, but they did revise those in 2001. And one of the reasons for the revision was that the sepsis cases skyrocketed, and they really felt that the SARS criteria that they'd come up with was perhaps too sensitive. And then, of course, in 2009, the RACs entered the picture, and unfortunately, they did take advantage of that confusion around sepsis and took back millions of dollars from U.S. providers. In 2015, CMS adopted the National Quality Forum measure to report sepsis called Sepsis 1, which really defines severe sepsis and septic shock. And then last but not least, in 2016, the Journal of American Medicine Association published Sepsis 3, which is a new definition stating life-threatening organ dysfunction caused by a dysregulated host response to infection, was the definition of sepsis. But the purpose of our webinar today is not to come up with a definition for sepsis, nor is it to identify which clinical indicators that we want to use for sepsis, because that really is out of the scope of coding and into the scope of the clinical folks. So we are just going to talk today about really what coders need and what are the resources they need and how can we come together as a multidisciplinary group. So I encourage coders to acquire as much knowledge as they can about anatomy and physiology to understand the conditions that they're coding and the rationale for assigning the codes that they assigned. Note that sepsis is a complex record review and often has a longer length of stay. So it can be a daunting task for a coder, especially a new coder, to take on the coding of a large sepsis chart. The availability of resources is extremely important that your coders have access to the updated official coding guidelines and also every quarter's publication for the coding clinic. And then we come to the physician documentation challenges, which are really big, and I believe the root of those documentation challenges is the competing languages that are used by the clinical world versus the languages in ICD-10, and we're going to take a look at that today also. There are a lot of extensive coding guidelines in the official coding guidelines for sepsis, and those really have to be well known by coders in order to use them and assign sepsis codes correctly. And last but not least, we're going to talk about the diagnosis of sepsis being on the OIG hit list pretty much every year. It is also a huge payer target. So auditing in the U.S. has increased about 936% in the last 5 years. So payers, if they're paying this amount of money for the diagnosis of sepsis, no doubt they're requesting records to ensure the medical necessity and really to look at what they're paying for. So here we have from the American Hospital Association Coding Handbook, the definitions that coders are very used to seeing to uncover a sepsis diagnosis. And like I said today, we're not going to spend a lot of time discussing definitions, but I wanted you to have those before you because we will talk about SAERS today. We will talk about septicemia. We will talk about bacteremia and how the event of ICD-10 has changed the language that will lead us to the appropriate sepsis code. So here I have some very brief definitions for sepsis, and the three that we are going to focus on, the three terms for sepsis that we're going to really focus on today are sepsis, severe sepsis, and septic shock. And so they could be fairly simple in the way I've displayed them on this slide, and we know that real life and patient care is not this simple, but for the subject of what we're talking today, this will do for us. Sepsis is a systemic response to infection. So the patient has developed a localized infection that has spread beyond just the local infection into a systemic involvement. Severe sepsis is when we have that patient with sepsis and they also have an associated acute organ dysfunction or failure. And then last on the slide, we have septic shock, which is circulatory failure associated with severe sepsis. So for our discussion today, these are the three terms that we are primarily going to focus on. In ICD-9, physicians got used to using the terms 2 to 4 or 3 to 4 SAERS criteria met when they were talking about sepsis. And in ICD-9, you can see that we had codes for SAERS due to an infectious process, and it was 995.91. We also had a code for SAERS due to an infectious process with acute organ dysfunction, and it was 995.92. But when ICD-10 came into effect, we no longer have a code for systemic inflammatory response syndrome of an infectious origin. We only have codes for SAERS of non-infectious origin. So I have been working with a lot of physicians to change that terminology to use the term sepsis instead of SAERS. Unfortunately, because our clinical and coding languages clash, that is the only way for us to get to the appropriate code for sepsis. And you can see also under the excludes one, we also have a code R65.2 for severe sepsis, which we're going to talk about later today. As questions come to mind, be sure and save them for the end of our webinar today when we're going to have a Q&A period. And also, I'm going to share with you my own email address because I can never resist a good coding question, and I frequently do receive questions around the ICD-10 rules for coding of sepsis, severe sepsis, and septic shock. So this is just a look at the official coding guidelines. And then my point in sharing this with you today is that the cooperating parties do not use the official coding guidelines to define sepsis, nor do they use those guidelines to instruct coders what clinical indicators to look for sepsis. Indeed, they stay away from that. There's actually an active coding clinic from 2016 that states, if we do have some clinical indicators and examples, they are not provided for you to validate a diagnosis of sepsis. But what the coding guidelines are for is to instruct coders on how to apply codes from the ICD-10 CM coding. It's not instruction for clinical indicators or clinical validation. So that's a really important point for you to remember today as we talk about the coding of sepsis. Of course, coders do need to be aware of what the signs and symptoms, treatment activities, medication, and diagnostic lab tests are used in the treatment and the diagnosis of sepsis. So we really want to have a really good knowledge so that we can be an integral part of this multidisciplinary team that deals with the diagnosis, treatment, documentation, and coding of sepsis. So understand what some of these signs and symptoms are that you're going to be described in the H&P when the patient's admitted. Understand what to look for as far as activity. Understand that the treatment is going to be some of the antibiotics that I have here listed on the slide. And when we have severe sepsis and septic shock, we're going to see the initiation of vasopressors to keep the patient's blood pressure stable. So it's important to understand and be very familiar with what these signs and symptoms treatment activities are for sepsis. Here we're going to look at the actual coding of sepsis. So the official coding guidelines are very matter-of-fact in telling us that in the coding of sepsis, the coders are to code according to physician documentation. So they're not supposed to be looking at blood culture results specifically for the coding of sepsis, because they tell us in the coding guidelines that we can use a code for sepsis even if we do have a negative blood culture. They are also not supposed to be looking at the clinical signs for sepsis and assigning a code for sepsis. It is based purely upon the physician documentation. And note, though, that sometimes your payers will use, in a denial for sepsis, they will say they're denying the claim due to a negative blood culture. In that case, what I do then is print out the official coding guideline that states we do not have to have a positive blood culture. And here on the bottom of the light green slide, I've shared that with you so you can look it up, that actually only 28% of patients with sepsis will have a positive blood culture. You can highlight that and send that in with your appeal letter on that denial and perhaps get that overturned. Some of the sepsis terms we're going to talk about today. Notice that in my first blue slide, I note that septicemia and sepsis have often been used interchangeably. Those terms have been used by providers interchangeably. And after the dawn of ICD-10, they're no longer considered synonymous in terms in coding. So we're really encouraging physicians to use the term sepsis, severe sepsis, and septic shock. Another term I want to be clear on today is the term of urosepsis. And now as I work with clients across the U.S., I'm not seeing the term urosepsis used as often. And I'm really happy to hear that, because in ICD-10 coding language, urosepsis basically does not exist. So if a provider uses that term to describe sepsis, or a urinary tract infection, the coder will have to query the physician to find out whether they're referring to a urinary tract infection or they're truly describing sepsis. So trying to get away from two terms is the point on this slide. The for coding purposes, we want to avoid the term septicemia and avoid the term urosepsis in our documentation, so that our coders can get to the appropriate sepsis code. Severity of illness, another issue around sepsis. And what are payers, I often get the question, what are payers really looking for? And so I try to share with my clients that payers are looking for what is that, they want us to answer the question, or what are the findings for this patient that can be explained by the local infection. And if those findings can be explained by a local infection, they're not always in agreement that the patient has sepsis. But severity of illness documentation can really take us up to the next level. So I have a few examples here on the slide today. One of those is if the patient's experiencing severe hypoxia, is it early or mild acute respiratory failure? And only the physician can answer that question. If we have urosepsis, is it a UTI with sepsis or is it a UTI? And once again, severe COPD on continuing oxygen, is it perhaps chronic respiratory failure? And so we want to have the physician document the most severe, to show the most severity of illness. And this today, this is a really important slide, and I want to be sure that I spend some time on it. It's really important that a practitioner establish a diagnosis of sepsis. And that can be done only with findings that cannot be easily explained by other causes. So So you see here on my slide the term, I have highlighted or bolded the term, not easily explained. So auditors are looking at these clinical indicators and they're asking the question, can these be explained by the local infection? And if they can, or if the physician hasn't adequately documented that these clinical indicators are indicative of the diagnosis of sepsis, that's where we get into the he said, she said scenario with our payers. So we have some of the criteria here that I have gotten from payers, and the first five are commonly given the greatest weight. But any and all of the criteria may be used by physicians to establish a diagnosis of sepsis based on their own clinical judgment. So that's a really important statement. So you might then turn around and say, well, Laura, if it's up to the physician and based on his clinical judgment, why are then payer auditors coming back and saying that the physician documentation is not establishing sepsis? And I have actually taken an example from a denial I got that I'm going to show you later. And the reason for that is payers are requiring clear and consistent documentation throughout the record. So we're going to talk about that in just a moment. What does that clear and consistent documentation look like? Well, it looks like a thread. A documentation thread of sepsis that goes clear throughout the patient's stay. If the provider documents that, they also, once the sepsis is treated and resolved, they document the term sepsis resolved. And always, always include the sepsis diagnosis of the discharge summary. And I often tell people that our discharge summary is very much like the hospital invoice. And it's really there that payer auditors turn to, that and the H&P both, to really see how sick the patient was, what was done for the patient, and what was the outcome. At what point was the sepsis resolved? There are also some sequencing tips that coders need to be aware of when they are using sepsis codes. Sepsis is not always the principal diagnosis. So it only is the principal diagnosis when it's present on admission, and when that definition meets the definition of a principal diagnosis. Now, there are a few exceptions, as is common within ICD-10, and I have put the coding clinic for one of those that talks about when sepsis is the principal diagnosis, and that is coding clinic 1989 second quarter. But note the most important thing on the slide is that coders cannot assume a link between sepsis and an underlying localized infection. The provider must make that link. Here's another special case of sepsis. When you have sepsis due to a post-procedural infection, it is a complication, and the complication code is sequenced first and is the principal diagnosis, followed by the appropriate sepsis code. Code assignment is based on the provider's documentation of the relationship between the infection and the procedure. Coders can never assume that just because a procedure was done that is connected to a complication for a post-procedural infection with sepsis. So be very careful with that. Sometimes it's hard for providers to understand that the rules in ICD-10 coding don't allow coders to assume what can sometimes be obvious. Organ failure is an important piece of the diagnosis of severe sepsis. And the reason I'm talking about this today is about 50% of the sepsis records I review actually met the qualifications for severe sepsis. And often the renal, heart, and respiratory failures, even when it's documented that they're accompanied by altered mental status or encephalopathy, can sometimes be missed if not clearly stated by and linked by the provider. So if a patient has sepsis and acute organ dysfunction, that has to be linked by the provider to the sepsis. And acute organ dysfunction, organ failure, the coding guidelines say organ dysfunction or failure is severe sepsis. And if you can't tell that, then of course the coding guidelines instruct us to query the physician. If you have documentation that looks like this, respiratory failure due to COPD, which is another cause, then of course that means it's not linked to the sepsis and is not severe. So So in order to query correctly for sepsis, here's some of the things I'd like to go over with you. Know your indicators for sepsis. Colders are great eyes and ears for CDI specialists and physicians when you can identify a chart early on that you're looking at and you kind of go, yeah, I just don't think it's all there, and then refer it back to clinical. Use key documents as indicators to query. Don't always remember to review the sepsis order, and I even encourage people to look at nurses' notes. Often nurses are the forgotten contributors to documentation, so they often can help us understand, though we can't code directly from them, they can certainly help us understand some of the hospital course and the indicators for sepsis. We should always query to clarify inconclusive or contradictory documentation. I'm going to share an example of that with you soon. One of the purposes of querying is to help providers improve their documentation. Sometimes we have to query when the present on admission is not documented by the provider for the diagnosis of sepsis, and I've cited a coding clinic for you there. So really, coding clinic is full of advice for coders in regards to the coding of sepsis. There's not a shortage of advice available to us. So query or not to query, that's the query or the question. So here I've provided a slide for you that is in accordance with the AHA's, and they have a paper out, let me see the title of it, oh, Guidelines for Achieving a Compliant Query Practice. So that's done by the HEMA, and this very much kind of outlines what some of that is. When the health record, when the documentation might be conflicting or incomplete, or there's not a definitive relationship between two diagnoses, or we really have to question whether or not the clinical indicators and treatment are related to a condition or procedure, or we have a diagnosis without clinical validation, then we are instructed by both AHIMA and CMS to refer to the coding clinic guidelines and query the physician for clinical validation. Best practice queries. I have a whole presentation that's a whole nother subject, but really queries should be done by accredited coding staff and CDI staff, and we should always be auditing our queries to make sure that our staff are well educated and that they are writing queries that are not leading and that they're only writing queries that are necessary. We don't want to burden our physicians with unnecessary queries. Our query practice always should be linked to our physician advisors and our quality staff. The three D's for querying are define, document, and defend, and we're going to talk about that a little bit more today because every record, inpatient record, that goes out with a diagnosis of sepsis, we want to be fully prepared to defend that record to a payer auditor. As promised, here is a paragraph taken from a sepsis denial that a payer sent, and it really is saying to the provider, you've assigned 841.9 for a diagnosis of sepsis as a principal diagnosis, and of course they received the coding summary to review it from their documentation request, and then they go on further to say that clinical evidence in the medical record does not support the assignment of the sepsis code. They go ahead and they do a note that the physician documented patient with 2 out of 4 Sears criteria. So this goes back to my earlier advice of using the documentation of the word sepsis, severe sepsis, and septic shock. So Sears criteria, 2 out of 4, is not accepted by this payer as a documentation for the diagnosis of sepsis. To validate sepsis, they say, the medical record is examined for consistent documentation of the condition and evidence of a systemic response to the infection beyond the expected local infection. So once again, they're asking that question I asked earlier, which is, can these findings be explained by the local infection? There is no infection, they go on to say, identified in the medical record. So as coders, we know that in order to assign a diagnosis of sepsis, we must have a local infection. Let's see, I'm down to almost the end of the paragraph here, and it says there's insufficient clinical evidence to support documentation in the records available for review to substantiate the coding of this condition. Therefore, what they want to do then is they want to remove the A41.9 code and replace it with R05 with cough as the principal diagnosis. And now I probably have some medical necessity people snickering because how are we ever going to get cough as a principal diagnosis to pass medical necessity for an inpatient stay? But this is an example of what people who are appealing and making decisions regarding these denials have to sort through on a day-to-day basis, and they can be quite complex. We really need to have a well-defined process that we go through when we are defending and documenting for a sepsis diagnosis. And we might begin by having a screening tool on admission that looks for clinical indicators. That's really important. And one of those might be looking for an order for blood culture. Make sure it isn't a complication of a procedure before we proceed to go on and have discussion about whether we have sepsis, severe sepsis, or septic shock. Make sure there isn't another principal diagnosis. And also we want to be sure we verify any CCs and MCCs that go along with that record. And my reason for saying that is that payers will use algorithms to pull records, and often they will identify records with one CC or MCC, and then it's really necessary for us to be able to defend the code assignment for that complication or comorbidity. And then last of all, we want to be in this concurrent review verifying sepsis on the discharge summary. And my point here also is that we really do need to have that defined process we go through, and it needs to be a concurrent process, not a retrospective process. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to look at a couple of examples I've pulled from records that have been denied by payers. And this is case study number one, and we have a patient here that has coronary artery heart disease, diabetes, and the provider has documented there are symptoms that are felt to represent sepsis. Placed on antibiotics, the patient's glucose showed marked elevation thought to be secondary to sepsis. Now, so you'll notice here the words used, and words really matter when you're documenting sepsis. Symptoms that were felt to represent sepsis and thought to be secondary to sepsis. So on this slide, I show the coding of that, and you can see we don't have a localized infection. So really, this is what auditors term low-hanging fruit. For this particular record, the admission was necessitated by signs and symptoms felt to represent sepsis, but the payer disputed the words felt to represent and asked, where is the localized infection? This is also missing the clinical indicators necessary. And so once again, low-hanging fruit for one of our payers to deny this record. I won't go through the rationale for the rest of these codes because I've looked at my watch and realized I'm going to have to move on at a pretty speedy pace. Let me go back one more time. I do want to make one more point, and that is this record will not be defended by a retrospective query. This payer is looking for clear and consistent documentation throughout the record, and even if you have a query where the physician says sepsis is present, they will not accept that, and it will not save this case from denial. My second case is an 85-year-old female who came to the ER with shortness of breath, hypoxia, productive cough, and progressive weakness. I want to point out the progressive weakness here because this is that's an important indicator. And then the provider has listed some clinical indicators that point us to a diagnosis of sepsis. He then has put in some really good documentation that shows really the toxic or the really ill things that are going on in the acute deterioration in the ER, and she was emergently sent to the intensive care. And then this final diagnosis is listed as severe sepsis with septic shock due to Haemophilus influenza pneumonia with acute respiratory failure. And here's the coding for that case. You'll see the sepsis code. You see the localized infection code of pneumonia. You'll see the severe sepsis code and also the organ failure of or dysfunction of respiratory failure. So this case really has some good ammunition. If it were to be denied, we could definitely appeal it with the combination of the sepsis, severe sepsis, and also the respiratory failure. So my answer to my question of would you need a query for this case is no. So here are some more things we want to be sure that we catch, and that is a documentation of the consequences of sepsis. There are many consequences that you can get from your medical staff that will help you understand whether they are due to sepsis or not. But I think just a few that are common, and we want to be sure that we've clearly and accurately documented and coded all of the manifestations of sepsis in the discharge diagnosis. So I'll give you an example of acute respiratory failure. If that is what is present, we want to describe it in those terms, but we don't want to say renal insufficiency. So being as specific and showing as much severity of illness as appropriate for this patient in your diagnosis and documentation. So really, what I want to say today, really, and on this slide especially, is it all comes down to the documentation. If you have a really good H&P that captures severity of illness and the depiction of the patient's signs and symptoms, you add to that an explanation of the significance of the patient's worked-up findings and a detailed hospital course. Your progress note should easily show the patient's progress day-to-day. Eventually, your progress note should say sepsis resolved. And then, of course, you want to go on to a fully detailed discharge summary. Now, back to the progress notes. We don't want to see copied and pasted progress notes that confuse not only the payer auditor, but can also confuse other caregivers caring for the patient when the same progress note is repeated day after day, and it's difficult to see the progress the patient is making. So I am suggesting to you today that not only do you have this interdisciplinary process that we're going to talk to in more detail, but some self-auditing can take place. And I think many hospitals have written to me about their mortality expired cases not showing severity of illness, and I've encouraged them to do some self-auditing and review those expired cases with a clinician and a coder prior to final coding. Review the cases that you may change from a sepsis diagnosis to severe sepsis, showing that severity of illness. So this is an important measure right now in quality. And reviewing cases with major infections that are not coded to sepsis to see if you're really capturing all of those sepsis records. So the role of the coder in all of this is very, very important. They're key in ensuring existing documentation supports the listed diagnoses and procedures. So two common challenges that coders face on a day-to-day basis is having the clinical indicators there without physician documentation of those clinical indicators, or the documented diagnosis without the clinical evidence to validate those diagnoses. So that's what our interdisciplinary team needs to work on. So we want to identify those documentation issues prior to final code assignment. So in order to do that, we need an interdisciplinary team. We need a coder, we need a CDI specialist with an effective CDI program, and we need to be working as a team with the coder, the CDI, and the physicians, and to focus on the documentation concurrently. And note I've said that retrospective queries will not solve this problem. So we really start that documentation and coding process right away after the screening tool shows us that we have an admission with sepsis. So this is straight out of coding clinic, and it's really the practical application because I still get questions from coders who are troubled by the fact that all of the pieces aren't there in the puzzle. So this is the advice that we receive from the cooperating party. If the physician documents sepsis and the coder assigns the code for sepsis and a clinical validation reviewer later disagrees with the physician's diagnosis, that is a clinical issue. It's not a coding error. facility or a payer, and notice the word payer, may require that a physician use a particular clinical definition or set of criteria when establishing the diagnosis. But this is a clinical issue outside the coding system. So let's talk a little bit about that. It says facility or a payer may require. So many of our payers, when they issue a denial for sepsis, refer to their own criteria. And mysteriously, we as providers and facilities don't know what that criteria is. So I would suggest that you reach out to that payer and request a copy of that criteria. There's no way to meet a criteria if you don't know what it is. So that's one step in coming to agreement with our payers. This is coding guideline 19, and it is very clear to coders and instructs them that the assignment of a diagnosis is based on a provider's diagnostic statement that the condition exists. Code assignment is not based on clinical criteria used by the provider to establish the diagnosis. So sometimes when I appeal sepsis denial, I make a note. It's pretty straightforward to me, but in the appeal, I may make statements like, the official coding guidelines are part of HIPAA law, and my personal feeling is that payers should not be denying codes based on provider documentation because we are clearly instructed to code them. So I often will put in my appeal that the physician's judgment is the reason for assignment of the diagnosis, and also that physician was to have direct face-to-face with the patient, and being sure to let the payer know that we are following the official coding guidelines, which are explicit in their direction and which are part of HIPAA law. So that's important to do. So we want to bring this all together, what I have said so far today in the last about 42 minutes. Bring it all together to a performance improvement plan which involves coding, physicians, and CDI people, and it will be a little different for each facility. Physicians document according to where they went to school and what they learned, and also in their own personal experience. So it's really going to take a whole team that focuses on your sepsis admission. And you want to get your medical staff to agree upon a definition for sepsis and agree upon the clinical indicators that you as a facility are going to use. I posted this as an example of some clinical indicators, and it's not because I believe that they're the best or they're the ones you should use, because that has to be determined by your medical staff. It's really just used to serve as an example. So you start out by having conversations with your medical staff leader. And you kind of introduce this idea to him of, can the medical staff get together and create definitions for clinical conditions such as sepsis, severe sepsis, and septic shock? Maybe you have a physician leader that can speak with the rest of your medical staff and convince them to adopt these definitions. It will lower the amount of physician queries they're receiving. It will lower the hospital's denial rate. They can adopt a hospital-wide policy or standard that's approved by the MedExec committee and have a facility policy to reference for documentation. This can also be used in defending denials. I will often take a denial, and if the facility has a policy on the coding and documentation of sepsis, I can use that policy to help talk with the payer. So once you have established this agreed upon definition of sepsis, severe sepsis, and septic shock, you'll need to educate everyone in your facility, all of your providers, on the approved definition. And your physician leaders can go out and assist you in educating clinicians, nursing, CDI specialists. And this will be difficult for clinical people to do because providers and clinical people are already familiar with these clinical definitions. Be sure and involve your physicians and especially your physician leaders early on in this discussion. And then the last piece of that being the CD staff and coding staff doing a pre-bill audit. Very important to know what's going out your door before it goes out there, and start to end the pay-and-chase model that we now have with Medicare. If you can assure yourself before the bill is sent out that the documentation and the coding can be defended, then you are set up to do much better than if you submit the claim, then you receive a denial, and then they take back money, and then the argument has to begin. So pre-bill audits for sepsis, I hope, are in everybody's future, and we are going to have a webinar next month that really goes through a workflow for pre-bill audits. But here on this slide, I've really shown you 7 reasons to begin that pre-bill review for sepsis chart. You can uncover that missed documentation prior to sending the bill out. You can ensure accurate coding and reporting. You will find educational opportunities if you're reviewing charts and you find that certain physicians are not sticking to those approved upon definitions, and that gives you an opportunity to follow up with those providers. Reducing your denial, 7, is very important, and the reason for that is under the new scope of work for 2018 for RAC, the number of documentation requests that you receive is going to be correlated with your denial rate. So the less denials you receive, the less requests for information you will receive. So these are all of those really important reasons to start those pre-bill audits. And in conclusion, I want to leave you with 4 thoughts. Sepsis is challenging due to the differing definitions that cross clinical care and coding. And that's really one of the things you want to seek to have your providers understand. We are not trying to tell them how to diagnose. We're not trying to change. We are just trying to teach them that that clinical language difference from ICD-10 and the clinicians is causing some of the bottlenecks for sepsis payment. Develop those definitions for sepsis, severe sepsis, and septic shock. Remember when you're working with providers that often when you flip to the H&P, you'll see a statement that describes the condition of the patient on admission, and it says, well-developed, well-nourished, maybe female patient in no acute distress. So when a provider auditor sees that statement, they're not seeing the patient described aseptic or toxic appearing. So that specific documentation throughout that physical exam is really important that we show how sick the patient really is. So last but not least, coders become proficient at recognizing and coding severe sepsis and assist in proving documentation. Many of the records coded to sepsis perhaps could go to severe sepsis, which does really improve your chances with payers. Severe sepsis is much more difficult to dispute than a diagnosis of sepsis. Here's that slide that Krista promised you. If you want external CEU credits, those can be given to you by sending your request to this email address. And it may take us a few days to get back to you. We are going to have some time for some Q&A. I made sure of that by maybe rushing a few slides. But here are some of the references I've used today, and you will find an abundance of references around sepsis, sepsis documentation, and sepsis coding. So I'm going to go ahead and turn the program back over to Krista, and we can take some questions and answers from our audience.
Yeah, we have a few that came in. The first one to pose to you is, what should a coder do when the physician documents resolving sepsis?
Oh, well, that is a good question, and we often do see the words resolving sepsis. So what does that mean? Well, there is a coding clinic from 2016 that instructs coders that when they see the term resolving sepsis, they do not use a sepsis code, but they use a code for the localized infection because the sepsis has resolved. So I don't know off the top of my head what that coding clinic is, but go ahead and take a look at first, second, third, and fourth quarters of 2016.
Okay. The next one we have come in is, how do you recommend approaching medical staff with this performance improvement idea?
Well, I really recommend that you approach first maybe the medical director or a physician leader that's well respected among your medical staff, and maybe you have your chief nursing officer with you, and the two of you just start a conversation. you know, physicians really like numbers, and perhaps you can gather some numbers on the number and the cost of inpatient denials around sepsis for your organization, and that could be a great way to start that conversation. In some respects, money does talk. So if you have a good amount of money that you've lost, and maybe in the last year or two in regards to sepsis denials, that might raise a few eyebrows among the medical staff. So start having the conversations is the first thing I would recommend, and recommending having some clinical support along with you.
We have another one here. If a physician documents sepsis due to unknown source, do we go ahead and code sepsis?
Oh, you're going to make me go out on a limb here. Well, I can do some research for you, but I guess off the top of my head, I would be going back to the physician about unknown source, because if the length of stay coincides with the diagnosis of sepsis, the patient should have been in the hospital long enough to establish the source of that infection. And it is going to be difficult. Coders are instructed to code what the physician documents. So if he documented sepsis, you're going to code sepsis, but I would definitely be going back to him to be sure that you can't find a source for that, because it is going to be difficult to defend and audit.
And we have another one. Can you recommend some resources for coders who want to improve their knowledge of disease and disease processes?
Oh, I can, actually. I have a book that I believe it was sold by the American Medical Association, and I can send out an email with the name of it, but I like to have a written source, and it has proven to be a great source, and it is an ICD-10 current, and it really ties in ICD-10 disease processes and conditions. And I'll go ahead and have Krista send that out. It's a great resource. Another great resource is your medical staff themselves. If you can ask your medical staff, a lot of the physicians and providers love to teach. And if you could have some lunch hours where you provide lunch for the physicians, they could come maybe and answer some coder questions, maybe at the time of your coding roundtable, and share some of their direct knowledge around the diseases that these coders are trying to code. That's probably one of your very best resources, is calling upon your provider staff.
Awesome. And I did want to throw out, we will be providing you guys with links to a recording to this and slides for the PowerPoint. I know we're getting some questions on that, so we will be making that available on the next few days. You'll get an email to a link that has both of those components for you.
Great.
So, yes. Can you repeat the coding clinic for resolving sepsis?
Resolving sepsis. I believe it's in 2016, but I'm writing myself a note so I can send that to Krista.
We'll keep sending.
She can send it out.
You'll get a follow-up email with that as well. So,
and, you know, the scenario where I see that a lot is where the inpatient has been transferred to long-term care. And when the long-term care people receive the record, it says resolving sepsis. So they might go ahead and inaccurately code the sepsis because it's documented. So, yeah, that was clarified in coding clinic. Before I sign off today, I do want to take time to invite you to next month's webinar. We're going to talk about the power of pre-bill audits. As I mentioned briefly today, I do recognize that pre-bill auditing takes time and resources. But I'm going to give you a few tips about that and actually talk about a workflow that might not be as disruptive for doing those pre-bill audits. So thank you for joining us today. And unless Krista has anything, I'll go ahead and sign off a minute or two early. I appreciate your attendance. Thank you.
I did send you guys in the chat the email for the CEUs and Laura Lakes. If you have any follow-up coding questions, feel free to reach out. We're always here for you. And that's all I have. So have a great day, everyone.